The How Radio Works video explained how radio waves are produced and how early radio sets worked. However, early radios suffer from various shortcomings in practice, so this video explains how radio designers came up with improved technology that addressed these shortcomings. Early radios were called tuned radio receivers, or TRF for short. As radio became more popular, more radio stations became available, and the TRF receiver was not always able to select one station without receiving interference from another station on a nearby frequency. Also, early vowels were not as effective at amplifying high frequency radio signals as they were at amplifying lower frequency signals. As a consequence, the superhet receiver was invented to overcome these problems. The superheterodyne receiver, often shortened to superhet, uses frequency mixing to convert a received signal to a fixed intermediate frequency, or IF. This can be more conveniently filtered and amplified than the original carrier frequency, and is able to discriminate between stations more effectively. By the mid-1930s, most domestic radio receivers were superhets. Virtually all modern radio and TV receivers, and also radar and communication systems, are superhets. This diagram explains the building blocks for a superhet receiver. The receiving antenna is connected to a tuner, which is used to tune roughly to the received signal, FR. The receiver has a circuit that produces sine waves from a variable frequency oscillator known as the local oscillator, or LO. The frequency of the local oscillator, FLO, is adjusted by the same tuning control as is used to tune the received signal. The dotted line in the diagram shows that the blocks are connected. The local oscillator is adjusted so it is a fixed difference from the received signal. For example, AM receivers often use 455 kHz as the difference frequency. The local oscillator and the received signal are then connected to another circuit called the frequency mixer. The output from the mixer is the difference between the local oscillator and the incoming signal, and is called the intermediate frequency, FIF. The IF retains the amplitude modulation of the original signal. The intermediate frequency signal is then connected to the intermediate frequency amplifier, called an IF amplifier or an IF strip. The filters are tuned to a fixed frequency that doesn't change as the receiving frequency changes. The fixed frequency simplifies the operation of the IF amplifier because it can be carefully tuned for best performance at one frequency and can filter out unwanted frequencies. The IF retains the modulation from the received signal. The IF is then connected to a detector circuit exactly as used in the TRF receiver described in the previous video. Finally, the detected or demodulated audio signal is filtered to remove the carrier, then amplified by the audio amplifier and sent to the loudspeaker. This is a Pye valve portable radio from 1955, similar to one that can be seen in the museum. The aerial is a coiled wire frame contained within the lid of the radio. The picture on the right shows that radio after it's been opened to reveal the electronics. The aerial is connected to the receiver and the required signal is selected by adjusting the tuning capacitor by turning the tuning knob on the front of the receiver. The tuning capacitor also adjusts the local oscillator frequency as described previously so that it is exactly 455 kHz higher than the received signal. The selected signal is converted to the intermediate frequency, IF, in the first valve, which is both the local oscillator and the frequency mixer. This enables the wanted carrier signal to be more precisely selected from unwanted signals received at the antenna. The intermediate frequency is amplified by the second valve and filtered to reject unwanted signals. You can see the IF signal displayed on the oscilloscope on the left. The third valve contains a detector which rectifies the IF signal and extracts and amplifies the original audio signal. The fourth valve amplifies the audio signal so that it is large enough to power a loudspeaker so that the original sound from the studio can be heard. The audio signal can be seen on the oscilloscope connected to the loudspeaker on the right. Although the Superhet made it easier to select the wanted radio station frequency, there was still a problem with interference from other signals that could not be filtered out. For example, electrical equipment operating nearby and passing cars produced electrical interference signals. This interference would be detected by the receiver's detector, and it was unable to distinguish between the required modulated signal and the interference. By the mid-1950s, an alternative modulation technique called frequency modulation, or FM, was introduced, in which the frequency of the carrier wave is varied. This animation compares amplitude modulation to frequency modulation. So in the case of AM, the amplitude goes up and down, mirroring the amplitude of the audio signal. In FM, the frequency goes up and down instead. FM was much less susceptible to interference because the receiver used a circuit that detected the frequency change in the carrier and not the amplitude, and this was able to ignore the effects of interference. Radios such as the Pye Fenman were introduced in 1955 that could receive both AM and FM signals. The FM signal was much higher quality and enabled hi-fi sound quality to be received by domestic receivers. To learn more about superhets, FM, and other technologies that Pye produced from 1896 to 1970, please visit Cambridge Museum of Technology.